His blood has paid the price. Most beautiful sacrifice. So we could be welcome here. When we were dead in sin, so helplessly lost within, He came as the truest friend. So we could be welcome here. Come, come, the Spirit and
good morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Thank you for joining us this morning by live stream. Thank you for being in the house of God this morning. Those of you that were able to join us in house, God is good. Amen. We got a beautiful day outside. And I have a trying one inside. You know, it was when I started studying the lesson this week, I went, ooh, I need to call Pastor and tell him let's switch. Because I'm not a teacher, so to speak. I can, you know, bring stuff and get real excited and get in the spirit and start really laying it out there, not just teaching it, but I guess you could say teach preaching it. And then when I was studying this lesson, it's a history lesson. So we're going to have fun today. But, you know, my history teacher was also my speech teacher. And he actually passed me in speech, even though I didn't like to get up and speak in front of everybody. I don't know how he did, but he did. So, but he always told me I had it in me to teach. I just needed to let it out. So we'll see what happens this morning. But as I was like, oh, I need to call Pastor and tell him let's switch, the Lord said to me, be instant in season and out of season. So this is my out of season this morning. And we're going to get started this morning looking on one race and many nations. As we get started this morning, let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you this morning that we have been able to come into the house of God this morning to learn about your word. Lord, we thank you this morning that we just woke up with the breath within us, and we give you praise and honor for that also. It is not a little task. And God, we thank you that we are here in your presence. And God, I just ask that even in this lesson, as it seems like it's just a history lesson, God, there is even things that we can learn from this. And I ask that I would say the words that you would have me say this morning in Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen. The central truth of the lesson this morning is all humans are descendants of Adam and Eve. We need to focus on and examine the provisions of God's covenant with Noah and celebrate God's goodness. The evangelism emphasis is the gospel is for all people of all nations. And the golden text is found in Acts chapter 17, verses 24 through 26, and it reads, "The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place." As we get into our lesson, one of the most important lessons we will learn from the chapter that we're going to be looking in today is that all human beings are descendants of one family. We came from one place. And it's funny that I was studying this lesson. I can't tell you how many times Kaylin has said this week that we're related. Everybody's related. We all come from Adam and Eve. And I'm like, has she read our Sunday school lesson? Because she kept reminding me this week. But we are all descendants of one family. We also are descendants of Noah and his sons. The modern concept that there is at least three races of humans, Asian, African, and Caucasian. Some scholars believe there's even more than that. But the biblical view is there is only one race. and that one race is human beings. The Bible has sometimes been displayed as being racial, but if you'll actually look at it, it is we are one body. We are the humans of God. Amen. We are created in His image, and it's time that we realize we all came from the same place. We didn't come from one and the other come from another. We all came from Adam and Eve. Then the flood happened, and we came from Noah and his sons. So therefore, we all came from the same place. And as far as I know, I don't know about you or if you have different beliefs, but as far as I know, there's not but one heaven. And we're all going to the same heaven. I heard somebody say here a while back, actually it was in the last 3 weeks, said they'll be glad that there's levels in heaven. And as I was walking by as they were saying this, they're glad that there's levels in heaven so that they don't have to be in heaven with the homeless. And I literally wanted to stop in my steps and turn around and went, well, I guess you won't find out because you're going to split hell wide open. But I didn't. Brother Mike, I kept my cool. I kept my lips shut. If he'd have been talking to me, I definitely would have. The point is, it don't matter if you're homeless. It don't matter if you're a multi-billionaire. We're all going to the same heaven. We're all going to be standing next to each other. And if you have a problem with that, then you might not be going to the heaven I'm going to. And it's time that we realize we are all one family, one blood, and one race. Why we acknowledge all the various peoples, the ethnicities, yes, I got it, and cultures of the world, we need to appreciate the diversity that there is in our nation. We must recognize the unity that we need to have within the human race. That is God's plan. That is God's design. It was not for us to put one human race on this side and one human race on this side and another here. It was that we were all one body under God. We're going to look at the text today in Genesis chapter 10, starting at verse 1. And I'm going to tell you this morning that me and pronunciations don't work too well, so we'll see how this goes with some of these names. My Spanish teacher even told me that I was too much a redneck and I couldn't pronounce the Spanish words right. So we'll see how this goes this morning. But we're look at Genesis chapter 10, starting at verse 1, and it reads, "These are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Sons were born to them after the flood. The sons of Japheth were Gomer, Magog, Madiah, Javan, Tubal, Meshach, and Tyrus. The sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz, Riphath, and Togarmah. The sons of Javan, Elishah, Tarshish, Kittim, and Dodanim. From these, the coastland people spread in their lands, each with his own language, by their clans and their nations." The table begins with the family of Japheth. The names listed here are of, if we continue to look, and I warned you, this is a huge history lesson, but if we continue to look back, we see that at the very beginning, it was ancient Hebrew descendants coming from that table. And we can see that it's primarily found in Europe and Central Asia. We're going to continue reading now in verse 6 of that same chapter 10. The sons of Ham, Cush, Egypt, Put, and Canaan. The sons of Cush, Seba, Havilah, Sabta, Rama, and Saptica. The sons of Rama, Sheba, and Dedan. Cush fathered Nimrod. He was the first on earth to be a mighty man. Now, I don't want you to think that, read that, and say, oh, he was a good man. What I want you to realize is this figure that is mentioned here in this chapter, the great figure, so to speak, is Nimrod. The great city is Babylon. He and his city is foreshadowing the coming of the Antichrist. And his city was what is Satan's kingdom. he may be assumed to have counseled and built the Tower of Babel that we're going to look at in the next chapter. But what I want you to realize is he led the first organized rebellion against God. God had just sent a flood, and he had destroyed all the world for us to start over, make a clean slate. He gave the humans a clean slate to start over and try again. And what happened? A descendant of Noah rises up, and instead of starting a clean slate, instead of being, he was a ruler, people followed after him. Instead of setting an example to be as of to be and follow God, he set an example to rebel against God. But if you look on in the scripture, it then says he was a mighty hunter before the Lord. A lot of people will say, oh, he hunted real good and the Lord blessed him with deer and stuff. That's not what this means. It has nothing to do with hunting animals, but it means the opposition of the Lord. He was opposite of what the Lord was. Therefore, it says, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. Nimrod instituted the very first organized rebellion against the Lord. And thereby the ways of the Lord, and also the ones that followed the Lord, he was rebelling against all of that. He would hunt them down. He would even kill the ones who worshiped Jehovah. Babylon always stood for every false religion, every false doctrine, every false way that was ever instituted in this time. That's what Babylon stood for. Even in today, some of the sci-fi movies you might watch, the real dark cities, they will be named Babylon. That's because Babylon was instituted as a sinful place. They tried to, I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but they tried to build the temple, the building, to be tall enough they could go into the heavens. And that's where they start getting the worship of the stars and the suns and the astrology worship. That's why I do my best to tell people that came from Babylon, you need to stay away from it. That's not what God made them for. He didn't make them for us to worship. But if we continue on and we look in the scripture, it says the beginning of his kingdom was Babel, Erech, Akkad, and Calneh in the land of Shinar. From that land he went to Assyria and built Nineveh, Hoboth, Calah, and the territory of the Canaanites extended from Sidon in the direction of Gera as far as Gaza, and in the direction of Sodom, Gomorrah, Admah, and Zeboam as far as Lasha. We're going to now go into Shem's descendants, and we're going to look at verses 21 through 22. And it says, to Shem also, the father of all the elder brother of Japheth, children were born. The sons of Shem, Elam, Asher, Arpachshad, I guess is how you say that one. That's one of those that's a little uncommon for me to say. Lud and Aram. These are the clans of the sons of Noah according to their genealogies. In their names and from these, the nations spread abroad on the earth after the flood. All the nations of the world sprang from the three sons of Noah, Japheth, Ham, and Shem. The sons of Shem was making mostly up the Jews and the Arabs, but the Jews, they do not recognize the Arabs in this capacity. They don't recognize the Arabs as being part of the Jews, and they made them the Gentiles, even though they were direct descendants of what was supposed to be the Jews. The Jews kicked out, so to speak, the Arabs and made them to Gentiles. As well, from this line of the sons of Shem, we would then see the coming Messiah. We would see the Savior of the world, the Redeemer of mankind. But it's ironic that even though the Redeemer came from this line, he is not recognized as such by so many of his lineage. It was his family that killed him. It was his family that hung him on the cross. It was his family that betrayed him. That lets me know that no matter what comes up in your family, there's someone that has already went through it. Amen. Jesus suffered the betrayal of family greater than we will ever suffer. Jesus went through the sorrow of seeing his own kinfolk hang him on a tree, of his own kinfolk being the reason that he was hung in the first place. And he's one that we can definitely look at as someone that I was very close to. His favorite saying would be, "And this too shall pass." So when it comes up that that family wants to get a hold of us and seem wants to tear us apart and all the friction come in amongst the family, it's we remember what Jesus went through with his family, and we can say, "And this too shall pass." Amen. But in the blessing of Shem, Noah also had called on the name of the Lord. This is a significant thing that we need to see, because when Noah blessed Shem, he called on the name of the Lord. And I believe that Noah's blessing is what set up Shem's line of genealogy for Jesus to come from. We would see that all of the people that came from Shem's descendants were ones that seemed to be spiritually minded, that seemed to have their mind on God. And so reading these, I want to say I'm part of the Shem clan. Amen. I'm one that want to have that spiritually minded to be after God's own mind. But two of the world's and one God's religion have come from this line, Judaism and Islam. Of course, our Lord was descended from Shem also, so thus that also means that Christianity came from this also. That is the roots that we see of Christianity. But if we look at a broader view of the scriptures, we see that Shem is another piece of the grand design that God planned from the beginning. The promise to Eve was that her seed would crush the serpent's head. We then trace that seed, and we find as we're looking at that seed from Eve and we look down the line and we see the different seeds that came out, we then see that it came to Seth, and then it came to Noah, and then it came to Shem, and then on to Abraham, and then on to David, and ultimately it came to Jesus. God had a grand design in plan, and I believe Noah stepped into that plan when he blessed his son Shem. I believe he stepped into that plan, and I believe, and the Lord's saying this to me right now, I believe, parents, that is where you need to listen to the word of the Lord. The Lord's showing me that history don't always mean that you're not going to have the Spirit move, amen? But the word of the Lord is telling me right now that this is where parents need to realize the blessings that they have, the power of their tongue that they have over their children. And it's time that the parents of today's world grab a hold of this and realize they need to bless their children in the name of the Lord. It's not as much as what you'll leave them when you leave this earth and go to heaven, the money, the monetary items that you might leave them, the cars, the houses. It doesn't, that kind of stuff doesn't matter. The jewelry that you might give them, that doesn't matter. But what matters, Sister Martha, is the blessings and the anointing of God that you leave upon your children. And Noah knew this. Noah knew that Shem needed the blessings of the Lord. And it's time we take what Noah did and we bless our children, because it's out of our mouth that they shall be blessed, because we're their covering. We need to make sure that we bless our children. But there is an unbroken line from Adam to Jesus, but God orchestrated that, and it was because of the flood, but God orchestrated human history to bring about redemption, salvation, and the ultimate defeat of Satan and his kingdom. He told Eve, "You will bruise the serpent's head," and the way she did that was her great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandson named Jesus hung on a cross, and even though the serpent, Satan, thought he had him, on that third day he rose and he bruised his head. Amen. We see that God makes sure, even in all of this history, so to speak, and descendants, the lineage of Adam and Eve down to Seth, we see that God orchestrated a grand plan to happen.
As we look on, we're going to look in Genesis chapter 11. Starting at verse 1. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words, and as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. This prince, so to speak, Nimrod, and his city Babylon, and the plain on which it was erected, Shinar, they all began to claim attention. Everybody started watching at what was going on. I mean, I don't know about you, but if a skyscraper was being built in the middle of Pell City, we'd start looking and finding out why a skyscraper was being built in the middle of Pell City. Our attention would go there. And don't Satan want to paint a pretty picture? And he's going to start building to get our eyes distracted off of the Lord. Amen? He's going to get our eyes distracted. And Nimrod started building Babylon, and as he started building the Tower of Babel, that's exactly what happened. People's attention, the ones that were following God, people's attention started getting off of God and started looking at this tower. But they represent Satan's efforts of using a man as his agent to dispose and to get rid of God's plans. And we need to make sure us as Christians are not blinded by the plans and the attacks of Satan. We need to make sure that our eyes are open, because all we have to do to see exactly how much Satan tried to oppose God's people, all we have to do is read this book. If we need a roadmap on how to be able to conquer the devil, all we need to do is read this book. And they were, even though Nimrod was erecting this building, God had a plan. And we need to look on that even though there was so many in the scriptures, as I said, you can read the scriptures and you can see the opposing princesses and the cities that occupied those pages of the Bible that come against God's people. I know that in the back of the book, there's another story, that there's a triumph Emmanuel, amen, and a Jerusalem that will overcome the Antichrist and Babylon, amen. And that's, we need to hold on to that, that no matter how many Tower of Babels might be erected to cause the focus on God to get it turned off on the towers of Babel of this world today, we need to realize that there's a God that we serve, that we've already read the back of the book, and he's already conquered the Antichrist and Babylon that is to come, that isn't got here yet, but he is going to conquer. Amen? We already know what's going to happen. If anything, that should even make us be more zealous, that's not the right word, but it's what come out, but be more, zealous, thank you, it just was not out right. We need to be more zealous of making sure we get people in to God. And that first scripture I read, it was saying that God does not dwell in the temples that's built by man. In other words, yes, he's here. Yes, his presence comes in. As long as we welcome him into the presence, then he will come in. He's a honorful God. He will not put himself upon us. So we have to welcome him in. And as long as we welcome him in, then he will walk in. But he is not just in these four walls. He's also on the outside. So that lets me know that we need to make sure that we lead the people in and turn them away from the Tower of Babel that's being built in our world today. Well, Amanda, that don't happen. I don't want you to think literally a Tower of Babel. I'm talking about the bars that is, you know, coming up all over the place, right across. I can walk through my yard and through a little section of woods, and there's a bar that they've just built. The other night, I didn't go to sleep till after 1 o'clock because the music, boom, da-da-boom, da-da-boom, was rattling my window. That is a Tower of Babel. I don't care if somebody's catching this on live stream and hears me say that and wants to come against me. That's fine. But it's exactly what is in the Word of God. That is things that is being built that is against God, and it is considered the Tower of Babel. There's other things that have said is coming into our town, a gentleman's club, all different things that is said to be coming into Sylacauga. Sylacauga don't need it. The crime rate's going up. What is going to cause the crime rate to go even up more? Bring in sin. I got rid of one bar that was in that building. I walked around it. It was right after me and Tony got married. I walked around it and prayed during the daytime while nobody was there. I walked around it like I was walking around the walls of Jericho. And I began to pray, and I began to rebuke that building from being there. And it closed down, and it's been closed for maybe 15 to 20 years. And now Satan's going to come again. Do you think I'm going to sit down? Nope. I'm going to go, and I'm going to walk around that building again. And I'm going to see God's hand. Oh, Amanda, that's crazy. That's taking the job away from somebody. No, when it is sin, it's not. Because they can come to God and they could open a Christian bookstore there. They could open a coffee shop there. They're not going to serve food. They're just going to serve alcohol. Well, they can change from alcohol and serve coffee. That's where we've got to realize that just because the, so to speak, Tower of Babels are being built, we don't need to sit down. As we look on, it says, and they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. Now, if you consider the materials that they had that they were using, Daddy's a carpenter. If you consider the things that they were using, they definitely did not plan for this city to be a temporary tower. The materials they were using, they decided to them that it was going to be there for a long time. They were going to put it up and it was going to stay. But they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we disperse over the face of the whole earth. When I read this, I said to myself, you know what's pretty bad? Is even Satan knows what'll happen if God catches you. Because they plainly say, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. Satan knew what the punishment would be if Satan got if God come in and got a hold of Satan. But their words was, they said. That's words that we need to look at. They said. That marks the undeniable evil that can get in our hearts. There was no regard that they needed to look in what God's was. They didn't want God. They didn't need God. And they said, let's build a tower into the heavens. In this one verse, we find that seedbed of rebellion that is going to start to grow against God. Whether it was then or whether it is now, there is beds of destruction that is trying to sow against God's people. And we need to realize what's happening, especially in today's world that we are living in right now. It has caused rebellion to get so strong against God. It reminds me of that scripture, and I don't know, it was a few years ago. Daddy said something about, you know, it's getting more like in the days of Noah. It's getting closer and closer to the Lord's return. And I talked with him. We talked about it, and I said, you know, Daddy, though, if you look at what was really the days of Noah, and we think it's bad right now, but you actually start looking and seeing the history and seeing what they did in the days of Noah, we're nowhere near close. That was about maybe 5 or 6 years ago. You look at it now, and I can't believe of how much we have grown in sin. How much this world is grown in sin. That even our 1, 2, 3-year-olds that are born boys are females are saying that they're of the opposite sex. It's not them, it's the parents. And that goes back to it's when our parents need to stand up and start proclaiming the word of God over our children. When we start need to proclaim the word of God through our house, the blessings of God through our house. But the Lord had told Noah and his sons to be fruitful and multiply and to replenish the earth. But now the ones that are following Nimrod are doing the very opposite of what God had told Noah and his sons to do. They were building a tower, and they were wanting to stay in this one location. All of them stay in this one location. But God wanted mankind to be scattered over the whole earth. But these rebels were determined to defy what God had desired. It is clear that the people were coming together in a revolt, in a prideful revolt against God as their Lord and ruler. They had fallen prey to the original lie that Satan told Eve when he said, no, it's not that you're not supposed to eat of it, but it's because you will be as gods. And so they took that original lie that was said by the serpent, and they believed that if they was able to build this tower and to get into the heavens, that they would be as gods. It's time that power, as far as power of Satan, is overruled by the power of the Holy Spirit. Power, people say they get the money is the root of all evil. It's not per se the money, it is the power that comes with the money that makes it the root of evil. And we need to realize that the people here got overconfident. They were conceited, so to speak. They declared their independence against the Almighty, and they wanted rule from Nimrod. They wanted rule from Satan, so to speak. And it's time that we see that even though that was so deceitful, and even though they had got from God, that God had a plan. God was their ruler and not Nimrod. Some scholars even believe that one purpose of the tower was to provide that observation platform to view the constellations. And they believe that's where worshiping the moon, the stars, like I said earlier, I was getting ahead of myself. But that is recording the practice of astrology, that it began there in Babylon. And then it began to spread worldwide. But the tower would have facilitated their astrological practices, and it provided a temple to worship these pagan gods as far as the planets and the stars. Idolatry and witchcraft is even linked back to Babylon, as is often the case in later scripture. We find that Babylon is synonymous with pride, with wickedness, and rebellion against God. What does that sound like? That sounds like the world today. They are in pride, they are in wickedness, and they are in rebellion against God. That's what we, if we have one Tower of Babel, it is the world that we live in today. The people have built the world as a Tower of Babel to rebel against God and what His Word says. Let's look at chapter 11, verses 5 through 9. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower, which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have all one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down there and confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. The Lord himself, scripture tells us, the Lord himself came down to see what the people were doing. It's not that God didn't know what was going on, because God knew exactly what was going on. He knew from A to Z what was happening. He knew the plans of the people, but he came down among them, and I believe that he came down among them to give them another chance, that if they looked upon him and truly could see in the spirit and looked upon him and saw him, that they bowed down and worshiped him, that he would change what would happen. But instead, they were so in the sin and in the wickedness that it had blinded their eyes, and they did not see the Lord walking in their midst. Now, I may be wrong. That's what I think. That's what I think happened, that the Lord walked right amongst them, but the sin was so strong in their eyes that they could not see the glory of God because they did not want to see it. That makes me think of, again, the world today. The sin, the wickedness has blinded us so much that we have not seen the glory of God. Back when the towers fell in New York, we had to go open the church doors, even in Childersburg, because people were standing at the church doors wanting to get in just to pray. People we had never seen before wanting to get into the church to pray. And then it started coming around records of people that wanted to get into churches just to pray. Please leave the doors open so we can pray. God put his hand down upon America, gave us grace and gave us mercy on those following days. Unfortunately, several lives, millions of lives was lost. Hundreds of thousands of lives was lost. But people turned to God. Unfortunately, though, they did not stay the path with God. Because all of a sudden, when things started turning out right and things started getting back to somewhat normal, then everything was all right and they could turn away from God. Then when they need God again, they'll come back and pick him back up. That's where we're finding ourselves in our day and time. But the Lord walked among them. He knew exactly what was happening, and he walked among them. And the writer here portrays the Lord in a human term, both by understanding and demonstrating his own personal involvement in this situation. That's why I believe it says the Lord walked among them. It doesn't say he hid. It says he walked among them. That's why I believe he walked down the street. He gave them another chance to turn to him, and they did not. That's how much sin can grab a hold of our bodies. But God took note that day of their unity. In verse 6, he showed us that unity that the people had there. But in this circumstance, this unity was not a good thing. It was not a good thing for the rebellion that was against God. They were unified in rebelling against God. And the Lord even said that they are capable. Nothing they plan, his words were, nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them, because they were unified. They were so unified that nothing they planned would be impossible. But God spoke of their prideful confidence, and they would attempt anything. There was no limit. There was no moral restraint on their efforts at achieving that self-determined goal that they had. And the Lord knew that. And the Lord came down and he intervened. And we see in verse 7, he says, "Let us go." I believe that meant all of the three of the Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. He said, "Let us go." And I believe it was a serious matter. God took it as a serious matter. And he went down and he caused the people to speak in a different language. I mean, can you imagine a whole family, perhaps clans that spoke in the same language, and all of a sudden comes down and you're looking at your brother and he's speaking a different language than you are? Because you was in such unity against God, God had to show you what his power was. And he dispersed them amongst the world. And with this different language, they couldn't work together because they couldn't understand each other. Their ability to build this tower now was ruined. Each worker now heard what seemed to be nonsense, and it scared them, and they ran. It was a resulting confusion. It made them go into separate groups. It made them disperse out among the world because they could not communicate. That's why I believe communication is our number one most powerful thing we have as human beings. In the job that I'm in now, there is several different ethnic people that come into my workplace. And I had some come the other day, and I couldn't speak to them. They were talking to me, and I'm standing there like, I'm sorry, I don't know how to speak your language. And he pulled out his phone, and he typed in his language what he was trying to say and hit the translate button, and it come over to me in English. And I went, why ain't I ever thought of that? So I went running, and I picked up my phone, and I pulled up on Google, and I said, translate to this language, and I began to type it in. I went over to him, and I hit the translate button, and it talked back, and we were sitting there talking back and forth through the phones, but we were communicating with each other. There was them, we were given power because we could communicate with each other. When we couldn't communicate, I had no idea what he was wanting, and he had no idea what my response was to him. We looked at each other like we were lost because we didn't know what to do. But when he started communicating to me through the phone, and I thought, well, I can do that too, and I went and got my phone and communicated back, that gave us the power to communicate with each other. Then I looked at my boss and said, now I can speak in another language, so that means I get a raise, right? Well, that didn't happen. But anyway, it was a try. But the Lord came down, and he caused this language to scatter the people, and they began to disperse. In verse 8, we saw they dispersed over all the earth. And that's where we see all various nations that we read in chapter 10 and in verse 7 of chapter 11. God said he would confound their language. In Hebrew, this is the word balal. Because of the language confusion that they had here, the site that they were at became known as Babel. And the tower is called the Tower of Babel, basically because Babel means confusion. From this chaotic place that they were at, first they were all in unity. They were all rebelling against God. And this place that they find themselves at now, all of a sudden confusion hits. And all of a sudden they begin to, that sinful pride that they had, that haughty arrogance they had, it now resulted in confusion. And it caused them to begin to scatter. But what I want you to see is, even when the devil thinks he's got something in hand, and even when he thought he brought unity and he was going to defeat God, God made sure that the devil wouldn't win, and he destroyed that unity. And what I want you to see is a contrast, a reversal of what happened on the day of Babel that occurred on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, where Babel was a city built by vain, proud people. Jerusalem was a city of God. Jerusalem was where God's people was. Where Babel was an attempt by wicked man to reach heaven, this is where at Pentecost, God and the Holy Spirit descended from heaven down to the people. Where there was a tongue that everybody was unified, but they rebelled against God in the confusion that God brought with all the different languages. God then brought heaven down to people, and they began to speak languages languages that they did not know, many different languages, and took them out onto the balcony so everyone else could hear them. And as they were out there, other people that heard them speaking their own language. God brought back what he intended to happen in the first place. Now, I have heard of people, actually it's even happened, that I've seen it from my own eyes. A man walking by the church, and the minister was preaching, and all of a sudden, the power of God get a hold of that minister, and they begin to speak in tongues. And all of a sudden, the doors open wide. The man come running down the middle aisle, hit the altar, and we came up there and started praying with him. And he started speaking to us. We had no idea what he was saying. The minister didn't even know what he was saying. And thankfully, someone that spoke his language come up and began to talk to him. And that translator looked at the minister and said, "You were speaking his language as he walked by the church, and you told him, if you do not come in this building and give your life to Christ right now, you will die by in the morning." Now, you can sit there and not believe it. You can listen to me online and not believe it. But I saw it with my own eyes. God can cause, even though that day he caused confusion, he has now turned around and he has put what Satan thought he had control of. And now on the day of Pentecost, God got that control back. Amen? What a lesson for us that no matter how badly the wicked people mess things up, the Lord is able to reverse and with his power and grace show up on the scene. Amen. We're going to continue now looking at verses 10 through 11. And chapter 11, and it says, "These are the generations of Shem. When Shem was 100 years old, he fathered Arpachshad," I know that ain't right, "2 years after the flood. And Shem lived after he fathered Arpachshad 500 years and had other sons and daughters. When Terah had lived 70 years, he fathered Abram, Nahor, and Haran." The account now that we have read so far today, what we have learned so far today, it now continues with one branch of Noah's family. The descendants of Shem, like I said earlier. We don't know much about the people that's actually in this lineage, but there is few individuals that begin, as we read, begins to stand out. And Shem's great-grandson was named Eber. And many think that this man was the root of the Hebrew language. If this is true, then the Hebrews originally included many more people than just the Jews. Eber had a son named Peleg, which means divided. Some Bible scholars speculate it was during his lifetime that the confusion and the scattering occurred at Babel, that he experienced the division of the people. And then we see in the remainder of chapter 11 that it traces for 10 generations until we get to Terah, who was the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And then we see the rest of the story of Genesis and Israel's beginnings. And Abram comes to be the primary character here in the rest of the book of Genesis. Shem, through his lineage, the Son of God would be born into this world. However, here it stops at Abraham as it begins to bring us the lineage. It stops at Abraham for a specific reason. It wants to share a story to us. It wants to take us on a journey. And I believe not only to tell us what happened, but I believe also of how to overcome things that we are faced. Because even Abraham was found on the backside of the desert. You know, many times he was the father that led many of the Israelites. He led them. He started setting up things for Moses and leading them out of Egypt. He led God's people. He was the father of faith. And I believe that the reason it stopped was to this man that the Lord gave a meaning of justification by faith. He was also the man that God said he was a friend of. I tell you today, I know that I'm a friend of God, amen? I know that I am beside God, amen? We look on into Genesis chapter 11, verses 27 and 32. And we read, now these are the generations of Terah. Terah fathered Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran fathered Lot. Haran died in the presence of his father Terah in the land of his kindred, in Ur of the Chaldeans. And Abram and Nahor took wives. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife Milcah, and daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah and Iscah. Now Sarai was barren. She had no child. We see here that Abraham has now come into view. Will prove that he was now one of the greatest men of God who had ever lived. Even though Sarah was barren, and Sarah being barren, you might think, why do we need to know that information? Because that bit of information, it significantly figures into the narrative that begins to follow on in Genesis. And we find that the Lord, years later, even when Sarah was 90 years of age, he would rectify the problem of her being barren. And in fact, from the loins of Abraham and the womb of Sarah would come the Jewish people that was raised up for an express purpose of giving the world the word of God. If it wasn't for them, we would not have this word. But because of that lineage, we got them writing the word of God, and we were given the word of God, and it raised up a lineage, an Abraham lineage, so to speak, that we would see the mighty womb that would continue on and would one day see a mighty womb opened up where the Messiah would be born. But we read on, it says, Terah took Abram his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his grandson, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth together from Ur of the Chaldeans to go into the land of Canaan. But when they come to Haran, they settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. This section of Genesis, even though you might read it and think, oh, Lord, that's that lineage stuff. Do I really need to read this chapter? It is very pivotal that you understand exactly what happened here, because we turn from a worldwide flood, and then we turn to a spiritual catastrophe at Babel, and we go to focusing on one man, Abram. And this account begins with Abram's father, Terah, who lived in Ur. It was, and we're wondering, why in the world do we got to know all this? But it was in the southern parts of Mesopotamia. In other words, the southern, today would be southern Iraq. And it was a prosperous city, but it was also known for a legal code that was devised by one of its kings. It was also a pagan city. And I believe that's why we have to know exactly this exact thing, is because it was a pagan city that paid special devotion to its moon god. And they called their moon god Nana. I believe it shows us that even though time and time again that God sent his spirit, God even walked amongst them and scattered them, they still didn't learn their lesson, and they went to another city and they built another image of their God, and they again turned their eyes away from God. And God spoke and said, it's time you get out of the pagan city. I believe that's one of the reasons we have churches today, so that we can step out of the pagan city, so to speak, so we can step into the presence of God. But what we as Christians need to realize that when we step into the presence of God, we need to keep the presence of God. We need to walk in the holiness of God. And when we walk out the door, we're taking that presence with us into the pagan city. And I believe that that is why we see the things here of the scriptures giving us exactly what happened with Terah and his family. That we see all the pagan worshiping and false gods that was going on. But something began to stir in Abram's heart. He became a true believer of God. He was one of those that knew there was something more than what was there. There was something more, and I believe Abram had already begun to start hearing the voice of the Lord. But for some unknown reason, we're not told why, but for some unknown reason, Terah decided that he was going to leave Ur and travel to the land of Canaan. However, this direct path to Canaan was through an arid, dangerous desert. And many would not attempt this route to Canaan because of that dangerous desert. But Terah followed the longer and more common northwestern route to the city of Haran. And from there, he began to travel southwest and entered into Canaan from the north. But traveling with him were his two sons, Abram and Nahor. Terah's son, Haran, died before he began his journey. And if we go on this track, we also see that Lot was there, which was Haran's son who had died. And we see that Terah's two daughter-in-laws was there. The writer notes in this scripture as we're reading it, the writer just immediately puts in Abram's wife was named Sarai. But see, Sarai was also not only Abram's wife, but she was also Abram's half-sister. And if you continue reading in the scripture, you see why God done that. You're thinking, oh, my Lord, you know, that ain't happening. I'm not marrying my half-sister. But God had a plan. And if you read on in the scripture, you find out that Abram had to look at a prince and say, she is my sister. He did not lie, because had he lied, I believe God's anointing would not have been upon him. He told the truth. And because of him not trying to deceive somebody, he told the truth. God then set him free again. Amen? And that continues on in another story in the Bible that we read on. But this record here that we have, that God's speaking to Abraham. But however, we don't seem that Abraham was shocked to hear God's voice, to hear God's call. He simply heard and he simply obeyed. Even though that it indicates that Terah initiated the move into Canaan, the Lord himself, I believe, caused this to happen. I believe the Lord himself placed a seed in Terah's mind to start the move so that he could place Abram right where he wanted him. And after this, we see that Abram went on to become Abraham. And Sarai went on to become Sarah. Sarah was no longer barren, and she gave birth to Isaac. And from Isaac's son, Jacob, the nation of Israel now is developed. And from Israel came the Messiah, the Lord Jesus. We see in these chapters 10 and 11, that it teaches us two lessons. The first is the problem is with us, is us. We are our own problem. After the great flood, the people were given a fresh start. They were given a blank slate to begin anew. But what happened? Nimrod and the Tower of Babel. I was playing the scripture this morning on the way here, and they said the word Nimrod, and Kaylin says, Nimrod, don't that mean dummy? And I was like, well, I don't know, but Nimrod was a dummy. So he built the Tower of Babel, and that ancient evil erupted because of this, but with a vengeance Our problem is not external a lot of times. Our problem is our hearts. Our problem is we don't realize that we are all one family. We are all one race. We are all one people. We need to realize and say that we are the children of God. That even the lowest of low sinners is a child of God. We need to realize that and be thankful for the lesson that we continue to read on in Genesis, where we see the story of Abraham. He brought him out of the idolatrous Ur, and he led him to Canaan. And that began the history of Israel, an account that developed in the coming Messiah. The stories that began to proceed from the creation to the fall, continued to the great flood and to the Tower of Babel, and it culminated with the coming of the promise of a seed of a woman. And even though this was a history lesson today, it let us see that through all this sin and through all the things that the devil thought he had the power on, there was a branch that was branched out of this evilness, out of this sin. There was a branch that came off where the Christ would be born. Truly, even though this was a history lesson this morning, it also is the story of Christ. And it's also where it leads us to know where our Savior came from. I pray this morning, I said words that encouraged you. I pray this morning I gave you something that you didn't even know that was in the Word of God. And I pray that this week is even better than your last. Amen. Let's pray for the service. Father, we thank you for this morning, the Sunday school lesson that you have given us. Now, Father, I ask you right now that your anointing would come in this place in a mighty rushing wind. Father, I ask you right now that you would anoint the ones that are sitting in this sanctuary, that are here this morning to praise and worship you. I ask that you would anoint the ones that are listening by live stream. Father, I ask that you would anoint the ones that are going by on the road, that they'll stop, park, and walk in. God, I ask today that you will have your way in a mighty way. And Lord, we praise you. We give you the honor and the glory that you so deserve, that your anointing is going to be on our pastor in a way it's never been before. In Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen.
The power of the blood.